Now we go to our next speaker. Our next speaker is Dr. Smita Pandey. Dr. Smita Pandey is going to be introduced by Dr. Saum Sheila, but since she's not around, I will introduce Dr. Smita Pandey. Yeah, Dr. Smita is basically, she did her long-term fellowship in glaucoma and also advanced cataract and phacoemulsification section fellowship from Shankar Netralaya, Chennai. She has various publications and presentations, and she has various honors and awards. She's received the best outgoing fellow in 90A segment from Shankar Netralaya in 2017. She received the runners-up glaucoma quiz at Shankar Netralaya Glaucoma Meet in 2017. She's a winner of PG quiz at Carvision Eye Hospital, Bhubaneswar. And she's also a runner-up at AIS PG refresher course conducted in Kolkata in 2014. So over to you, Smita, to present your case.
Good evening, sir. So I'll just start the sharing. Is it visible, sir?
No, your slides are not visible yet. Yes, Smita, now it is visible.
Okay, sir. Good evening, everyone. Thank you for this opportunity. So without further delay, I'll go to the case. So we had a 79-year-old gentleman who presented to us with loss of vision in right eye for 2 months, which was associated with pain. The patient had undergone phacotrab in that eye, which was eventful. He had PC rent in that eye. And he had undergone secondary IOL implantation and AC wash in that eye. We had incomplete records. The old records were incomplete. The patient was on 3 AGM in that eye. On examination, the right eye had inconsistent PL with a flat bleb, corneal edema, and the pressure was 44 millimeters of mercury with 360 degree sinical closure of the angles. Fundus view was very hazy, but it had glaucomatous optic atrophy. Left eye had immature cataract with normal IOP, and gonioscopy showed occludable angles with a pass temporally. The disc on undilated examination was healthy. So we decided to do left eye YAG peripheral iridectomy. On dilatation, the left eye was completely normal, fundus was normal, and the field showed generalized reduction of sensitivity. So with this, we came to provisional diagnosis of right eye being a post-eventful phacotrab for possible primary glaucoma and left eye immature cataract with the primary angle closure. Right eye nil visual prognosis was advised, and left eye he was advised to have regular follow-up and to plan cataract surgery in later visit. Thirdly, after 2 months, the patient comes with redness, severe pain, headache in left eye for past 1 month. In the local ophthalmologist records, the pressure had been as high as 50 millimeters of mercury, and the patient was now using 3 AGMs in both the eyes. On examination, right eye was same status, and with 30 millimeters of mercury pressure. The left eye showed lid edema, congestion, chemosis. You can see the dilated episcleral vessels. There was corneal edema. Peripheral chamber was shallow. There was mild flare, mid-dilated fixed pupil with a patent PI. The pressure was 36 millimeters of mercury, and gonioscopy showed 360 degree, almost 360 degree sinical closure with only few clockers of PTM opening on indentation temporally. The disc had progressed to 0.8 bipolar thinning, and the field showed the same. So summarizing the case, we had a case of, we had a patient who was diagnosed initially with primary angle closure, which was not on any AGMs. And then he progressed to advanced glaucoma, uncontrolled on 3 drops, and he was symptomatic. So what was actually happening here? Was it a drug allergy with a primary uncontrolled glaucoma? Or there was some associated uveitic entity which was causing this uncontrolled glaucoma? Or there was a component of raised episcleral venous pressure? Or there was just associated conjunctivitis with uncontrolled glaucoma? We gave a trial of stopping brimonidine, fluoromethylone, and ciprox drop to the patient, and the patient was put on maximum therapy. Even with that, there was no improvement in the symptoms or drop in IOP. The left eye IOP was still 42 millimeters of mercury. So we decided to further investigate. MRI brain and orbit was done to rule out any cause of venous congestion, and ultrasound bimicroscopy to look at the ciliary body and the lens status. UBM showed 360 degrees supraciliary effusion, and the MRI showed circumferential thickening of left ocular cords, which can be seen by the white arrow, and an enlarged lacrimal gland, and there was periocular edema. The MRI was suggestive of orbital inflammatory disease. Clinically re-looking, there was a mild proptosis in left eye. The patient was ANA and RA positive. The patient was started on 70 milligrams of oral steroids. Serum IgG4 workup was also advised by the rheumatologist, but due to financial reasons, the patient could not do it. And the patient was started by the rheumatologist on mycophenolate mofetil. Patient showed very good response. Within 2 weeks, the congestion, chemosis had reduced. The IOP dropped to 22 millimeters of mercury on 3 topical medications. In view of advanced disc damage and cataract, the patient was advised ecotrab under steroid and immunosuppressant cover. The surgery went uneventful. There was a good post-operative IOP control. The follow-up is awaited, and we plan to do MRI at the next visit. So, orbital inflammation can cause glaucoma. The IOP rise in these cases can be divided as open angle as well as angle. It can cause acute angle closure glaucoma also. Usually when the episcleral venous pressure is high, it can cause raise in IOP. Also, the venous stasis and the inflammation leads to a choroidal and supraciliary effusion, which leads to anterior rotation of the iris in the lens diaphragm that can cause angle closure. In these cases, usually IOP gets controlled once the inflammation comes down with the use of steroids. There have been several case reports where orbital inflammation has precipitated into angle closure glaucoma has been described. So this, I would like to ask the esteemed panelists these questions.
I think that was wonderfully presented by Dr. Smita. The case is open for discussion. I would invite Dr. David to offer his comments on this secondary angle closure glaucoma because of orbital inflammation. So, Dr. David, sir.
Yeah, I mean, this is a really tough case to know the exact etiology. Obviously, the angle appeared closed and there was ciliary effusion, so that seems to be potentially causal. They had an unfortunate event in the other eye, so you're really working on the only seeing eye, which makes it an even more difficult case. I think that this is some sort of inflammatory disease, whether the cause of elevated pressure was congestion of outflow or the angle closure is not 100% clear. It seems like on most exams, the angle was partially open and not completely closed. So to me, it probably was reduced outflow, probably, through venous backup would be my guess, just based on the ocular coats being so thickened. I think, obviously rapid diagnosis and trying to get the inflammation down so that the pressure would come down made sense. In terms of just treatment, when I see pressures in the 40s in a one-eyed patient, I would try to get something done as quickly as possible. Obviously, an inflamed eye. I have no idea of the timeline on this case, but those would be the issues for me. You did all the diagnostics. They clearly have an autoimmune tendency. And so I think that the follow-up recommendations to see how the eye is doing and to try to get a definitive diagnosis from a rheumatologist would be helpful. Tough case.
Thank you, Dr. David. Dr. Smita, can you share your last slide on the screen?
Sure.
Yeah. Dr. Vijay, there's a question to you. I mean, do you think that this can be a recurrent phenomenon of orbital inflammation and repeated attacks of angle closure?
I am also part of the management of the case. So it's I would request Sirisha to comment. Then maybe I will take it later, the question.
Yeah, Dr. Sirisha.
So very challenging case and very well managed. The only one question that I had when I was just going through this case was post PI, what was the angle status once the PI was done and then the patient came back?
What
was the gonio status post PI?
The angles were open after PI, ma'am, with the pass in temporal quadrant.
Okay, the rest of the quadrants were open.
Yes, ma'am.
So what it looks like is possibly it's a dual pathology, already has an angle closure, which is treated by a PI. And the other thought that I had was, could it be a PIS, platovirus kind of a situation where there was some amount of progression, but in 2 months' time, progressing to such a severe stage is very, very unlikely. So it's most likely a secondary angle closure added on to the primary pathology that the patient had. So only those secondary causes would cause such a drastic and a fast involvement. But one question I had is, we do see a lot of orbital inflammation cases, but we rarely see them being referred to us. Thyroid cases are more commonly referred to us rather than non-specific inflammation in the orbit. So how common has it been for you to see this?
Can I make a comment now? I think agree with you. Possibly there are two clinical conditions. Maybe predisposition of the eye, that is patient had PSA already, has made things worse. Possibly it progressed faster because of that. Suppose it was a wide open angle, patient would not have developed such a closure with a raised IOP. That's all I can think of. Maybe patient had a predisposition. So there are two events happening in his eye concurrently.
Ma'am, if there was no angle closure component, I mean, if it is due to a secondary cause of orbital inflammation, then is PI a must in these patients?
No. I think if it was an open angle, and if the inflammation produces a secondary angle closure, if you have evidence of choroidal effusion and UBM, treating the effusion will relieve the angle closure. There is no need to go for the PA at the time. When patient came first time, patient didn't have any inflammation. This happened much later.
Mm-hmm. Just to add,
the classic case of that is topiramate, right? You see a totally flat AC, but it's cellular body effusion, and then it goes away completely after removal of the drug. I'm sorry, Dr.
And I just wanted to add that this kind of a presentation is also seen with posterior scleritis.
Yeah. So
especially if they are unilateral presentation, it's not uncommon to see this, and very, very dramatic. And there, obviously, the V-scan as well as the ultrasound would help.
Yeah, I think the MRI didn't show any evidence of it. There was a question from Rajul, how can you rule out the scleritis? Yeah. So there was no evidence of thickening of the sclera on the MRI and also when they did the UV.
There's a question, what precautions should be taken in advanced uncontrolled glaucoma in inflamed eye?
What precautions? I think the patient was investigated extensively, and uveitis specialist, oculoplastic person, rheumatologist both have examined the patient, started the medication. Once the inflammation has subsided, I was quieter because it has produced significant damage to the optic nerve. Then only the patient was taken up for the surgery. I think it took two weeks. Am I correct, Smita?
Yes, ma'am. 2 weeks.
2 weeks.
The patient was controlled also on mycophenolate. So was the patient continued on systemic steroid along with this mycophenolate mofetil?
Yes, sir.
So what was the dose?
Pardon?
What was the dose of mycophenolate mofetil?
That was 500 milligrams.
500 milligrams.
Yeah.
And systemic steroids were also continued along with that?
Yes, sir.
Patient was operated, the phaco with PCIL was done under cover of systemic steroids. So along with systemic steroids, both the agents were continued.
I can't hear you, sir.
The question is, along with the steroids, mycophenolate continued when you did the phaco surgery?
Yes, sir. It was continued. The rheumatologist had given it for a dosage of till the next blood workup is done. So the patient was continuing with mycophenolate.